I'm trying to remember what the standoff is.
The standoff in the club.
Oh, yeah.
With Diamondback and all that.
So you know then?
That it's his half-brother?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh.
Spoiler alert. What's going on, ladies and gents? Dalibor here with T3G, and today we're doing another Tangents vlog.
A Tangents vlog, and also as well...
we're talking about Luke Cage a little bit.
A little bit about Luke Cage, but mostly we're going to be talking about what the ranking is for a bad movie,
yeah,
or an awful movie,
yeah,
and where does that, you know, where does the line meet that? So, but there will be, of course, if this is a too long of a video, make sure to check out the link below for the podcast so you can listen to it instead of watching. So,
here's the thing: I hear the term terrible
and awful
and god-awful.
Listen, thrown around
so much on the internet when people talk about movies, especially new movies.
Yeah.
Especially with movies like Batman v Superman.
Yeah.
Movies like Suicide Squad.
Yeah. Even the Dracula movie.
Yeah. Dracula Unbound, which I thought was a good movie.
It was a good
movie. Not an outstanding movie.
Not an outstanding, but it was a really good movie.
People like to throw around this idea like this is the movie was just a sideshow. It was a, you know, it was garbage. Have you ever seen a little movie called?
You can say.
I forgot the name of it.
Blood Rain.
Blood Rain was made in this was probably like 2003.
Because
this one I was a blind.
And I think they made two of them.
It was Kristana Loken.
I don't even know.
I think it was Kristana Loken. This was made in the day when video game like spin-offs were made just like left and right. This is like what made the idea of a video game movie a joke, because they just made so many of these bad, terrible movies.
They're terrible.
I'll tell you this. I watched the entire House of the Dead front to back.
I watched House of the Dead.
Of the Dead is a bad movie.
Yeah.
I am fully aware of this.
It's a bad movie, but I still had some kind of entertainment.
I turned off Blood Rain.
Yeah, Blood Rain's god-awful. The reason we're talking about this is not only because critics are talking about this, but there's a little show that we like to watch that likes to throw this
Collider Movie Talk.
Yeah, Collider Movie Talk. Specifically, and hopefully they'll get to see this, because they like to throw around the word awful, bad, leaves a bad taste in your mouth, and you have to redo it,
Most recently
that.
They were talking about the
Dracula.
Paramount or Universal, whatever.
Universal owns it.
So Universal's Monster Universe,
yeah,
that, you know, the Godzilla movie is part of, the Kong movie, the Mummy movie that's coming out.
Yep.
Dracula was actually supposed to be the first movie of that series.
Which did actually really good across seas, apparently.
I like that movie.
I
think it set up a modern-day Dracula well.
Yeah.
I think it gave us a new telling. I like the story.
Well, here's the thing. It's not even a new telling. It's just a telling we've never seen from him being Vlad and becoming Dracula.
Yes, we have.
I mean, maybe we have, but
Bram Stoker's Dracula.
Which one?
Bram Stoker's Dracula.
How long ago was that?
I mean, that was like 95. Listen, it had Keanu Reeves in it. You shut your mouth. It's a good movie. What I'm saying is...
But did that show... Oh, I guess it did.
Yeah.
I guess
the whole
it
reason
did.
He becomes Dracula.
Yeah, I guess it did. Which we see a similar story here. Mm-hmm. He wants to... Like, nobody said he is a good guy. He clearly becomes... Like, he's a good guy, obviously, as a human. Mm-hmm. But once he realizes what he has become... And what gets taken from him, he becomes Dracula. He becomes the Dracula you know later
on. Well, here's the thing. Here's my problem. I mean, I can't say this for sure, of course, but I think that a lot of people are upset about it specifically because it tried to make him be a good guy.
But I mean,
like, even in Bram Stoker's Dracula, you got to see Vlad prior to that, and Vlad was like the killer of killers. He
right.
was the soldier
sure.
they sent out to just murder people.
And I mean, that's what you even saw here too.
And when he came back, in Bram Stoker's Dracula, when
sure.
he came back, the reason that he turned his back on the church and, you know, just this went this like complete opposite way was because he lost his wife. His woman.
Yeah.
And was she his wife?
I don't remember.
Like, anyway, she killed herself, and they refused to basically, like, the church was like, no, she can't go to heaven. And he was like, fuck you guys.
Yeah.
Long story short, in, as far as I know, all, but maybe most Christian religions, suicide is no go. No.
Right.
Do not pass go. Do not collect $200.
That's right.
So he was like, I just went out there and, like, served and killed for the church.
Right.
For, you know, I killed hundreds, thousands of men.
Yeah.
For the church. Do me a solid.
Right.
Cleanse her soul. Let her pass.
Yeah.
They're like, no. And he's like, fuck you guys then.
Yeah.
And in this situation, it was like, we have no solution. We are going to get slaughtered.
Yeah.
This dark, evil thing, it might get us out of this situation.
Right.
I'm gonna go handle this.
Yeah.
And that's it. So I think that the reason that people are mad is because him becoming Dracula was not, like, in reaction.
It was for a good cause instead of self-sacrifice. Right, sure.
It was self-sacrifice, and then he, like, couldn't really deal because, right, you know, he's a vampire and his family is...
Here's the thing. I mean, I guess in that sense, that's fine, but...
So I understand it, but... I still think it was a good telling.
I think it was a great telling. I think visually it was a great movie.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can't even complain about the visuals in that movie. I thought they were great. I can't remember one scene that I was like, nah. Like, I enjoyed the entire thing. I think Luke Evans is a good actor. I think he's close to being a great actor. I think he just needs more movies to really show off his skill. But I think he has the chops.
I think he did a good job.
Yeah, absolutely. So I don't think, like, when you say... and specifically Collider, when you say something that is awful, you gotta understand, when we're thinking awful, we're thinking blood rain, and that's god awful.
There needs to be like a scale, right? Yeah. We need to judge it, right?
Like, I get you, like, didn't...
Fantastic Four from...
A bad movie.
The horror, you know...
I wouldn't say it's awful like Blood Rain, because Blood Rain is pretty despicable, but like... who was it? Was it Fox? Fox owns it? Fox should never make a Fantastic Four movie. I enjoy the previous ones.
You know what's funny? Just for a little aside, this is where tangents comes in.
Yeah, of course, tangents.
The whole time I'm watching Luke Cage, they keep talking about, like, his shirt is getting messed up. He's so sick of changing his clothes. And I'm like, she was talking about elastic cells.
Yeah.
And I'm like, all I can think about is that they're setting the groundwork
for
a Fantastic Four show.
I hope so.
Like, they're just setting the groundwork, because if you're not aware, in the Marvel Universe, in the comics, Reed Richards creates the unstable molecules that are everyone's clothes.
Yeah.
And that's what makes them, like, easier to repair. Sometimes they just repair themselves. Sometimes they're, like, more durable. They're more like armor.
I truly hope that Marvel has figured out how to speak with Fox and get those rights back.
I'm saying...
because there's no way Fox, for some weird reason, Fox really was like, no, we're still going to make a second movie. No, you're not, Fox. You lost money.
No.
Nobody makes a second movie on a loss. And you legitimately lost. You didn't, like, lose because, oh, you made the budget, but you didn't make the advertising budget. No. You didn't even make the budget.
They got buried.
You got buried, Fox. You were not making a second movie. Nobody was even coming back for that second movie. Get out of here.
Listen, all I know is, based on what I've just found out about Logan, I think they need to focus on their X-Men universe.
Because
here's the thing. They wanted to do Old Man Logan so much.
They did. Yeah, they really did.
I think they're going to screw it up. Here's the thing. I think you agree with me. I don't think Old Man Logan was a great story to begin with.
I mean, I told you that after... because I was the first one to read it between us. And I said that. I was like...
I think
it's good.
You have Wolverine Origin. The original.
That is a great story.
Outstanding story. To then, like, people do put it up with Old Man Logan. And I'm like, you can't put up Old Man Logan up next to...
No.
Like, it's like saying...
No.
It's like saying League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, which is done by Alan Moore, is as good as Watchmen.
Right.
It's not.
Right.
I really, really like League. I like both books. Watchmen is a whole other, like, experience.
Yeah, absolutely.
So you can't, like, even if it was the same writer, it's not the same level.
Right.
So to me, I feel like if you're going to talk about this movie, and they're saying that it's set in 2024.
Right.
And that he's got X-23, so he's got the kid.
Okay, so he's got the kid. Which makes sense with the poster.
Right. And they're talking about, I was watching Source Fed Nerd, and they were talking about, like, oh, you know, she later on becomes the new Wolverine. And I'm like, yeah, but if that's the direction they're going to go, that means all Wolverine stories from now on will be set in the future.
Yeah. So they have to be.
So completely outside of the other X-Men
movies. Although they're saying that we will... I guess it's a rumor. I don't know if it's a fact. But in the same story where they were talking about Logan and the poster and the title, they also said, now we know that...
Patrick Stewart?
Not Patrick Stewart, but... the guy that makes the gene clone... What's his name?
Oh, Sinister.
Yes. Apparently, we know that Sinister is going to play a thing in Logan.
I can see that. If they didn't want to get complicated and talk about Weapon X again.
Right.
Because we've really spent a lot of time with Weapon X.
I mean, yeah.
Over like 3 X-Men movies.
Sure.
Deadpool. Yeah. The Wolverine movies. Yeah. Like, we spent a lot of time with Weapon X. So if they don't want to talk about Weapon X.
Right.
She is a clone.
Right.
That is Sinister's bag.
Yep.
Easy connection.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I have no problems with changing that over.
But this is a huge tangent. Let's go back
to... The point is, Fantastic Four sucked.
Yeah, and so we have that probably at bad. Not awful, but definitely bad. Because...
Here's the thing. Fantastic Four is not worth money.
No, it's not worth the money.
Fantastic Four is not worth
the money. So it's bad, not worth the money.
If it came on TV, if somebody was like, I really want to watch it, I'd watch it.
I don't think I could.
If I didn't have to pay for it, if I didn't have to...
Right. Like, if you didn't have to spend any
addition. If it only cost time.
Right.
I'd watch it.
I don't know if I could.
If somebody said, I really want to watch Blood Rain,
no,
I would leave.
Yeah. Blood Rain is awful. God awful.
If somebody, even as a joke, said, I want to watch Blood Rain 2, right. I'd defriend them.
Right. So now, let's go back to these critics and Collider that say some of these movies that are nowhere near Blood Rain's level. How can you say, I get it, okay, maybe you didn't have the experience that you were hoping for.
Sure.
But to take into consideration, was the acting bad? No, the acting wasn't bad. You can't say Listen, we had good actors in Fantastic Four, and that script was so bad that they couldn't even save it. So, like, that's, like, even they had semi-bad acting... Why is that dog losing his
mind? I don't know.
Even they had semi-bad acting due to how bad the script was. Like, it wasn't because of them. It's just there was nothing they could do to save that. They did right. as much as they could.
Right.
So that's bad. And then you have awful where, like, it's not even a script. I think they're just throwing lines out. So to say Dracula, to say Batman v Superman are... awful or god, which let me rephrase that. Collider didn't say that Batman v Superman was god awful or anything like that.
They took the position of most people online,
right?
I really liked it, but I had all these problems with
right.
And it's pretty much the position of everybody with Batman v Superman,
except for me. I was fine with it.
I had problems with it. I feel like they had opportunities to do way better stuff for the cameos for Justice League, like way better. The like, I forget who said it, but it basically like. At some point, somebody's got to pay Lex and LexCorp for, you know, their design, logo design for them, sure. For all the Justice League members. Like, at some point, like, I feel like that was kind of forced in.
But here's the thing. I don't think there could have been better options.
I just think there could have been better options. Like, I think you could have maybe... If he had one or two, I'd be fine with that. Like, if he had the Cyborg, which makes sense... You know, it's related to the ship
research
he's doing.
But here's the thing. But then you're talking about incorporating all the characters somehow into the movie.
Not even. I'm talking about, like, a side. Like, not even, like, a... That's the thing. They were such focused cameos. Like I said, if he had one or two of, like, the research... Like, the security camera footage for Flash, I think, was understandable.
Okay.
And the Cyborg thing, it makes sense because it would have completely tied in.
The Woman thing makes sense.
But it was just a picture, unrelated to anything else.
But yeah, but then he started noticing patterns. Maybe he started noticing...
I mean, maybe that was the first one. Right. So that's how you tie in Wonder Woman. You could have done Aquaman real easily. The whole thing with the water at the end, easy connect. And I mean, like, you don't even have to show him. He doesn't have to be on screen.
No, I got you.
Just like show them the background. Like when whoever, you know, whoever jumps down there to get the thing. You know,
we're going back into discussing Batman v Superman.
I'm just saying there were opportunities. I think, but I still think it was a fun movie. I think it was an enjoyable movie.
So you can't say
it was kind of dark, but you know, kind of par for the course.
I mean, right? But I mean, that movie is there's nothing bright about that movie. Like, it's Superman being judged by human beings. Superman paying atonement for.
I still love to see the extended cut. I'm still not super happy about that whole Superman arc. The Batman arc makes a little more sense. Like I said, if I don't diagnose the story, the plot, I think the acting is outstanding. I think the plot itself is what had the holes in it for me. I think that the acting was outstanding. I think the visuals were great.
Zack Snyder.
Everything outside of the plot itself, I think, was great. I think the plot is the only place I have problems. And for me, that's one of those things, like, I can turn that off and just enjoy the spectacle. If I sit down and, like, if I go into it and I say, you know, if I'm looking, not looking for problems, but if I watch it for plot, the Superman arc didn't make sense as shown in theaters. From what I understand, the extended cut has some more stuff that explains it some more. Cool. I'm still looking to watch that. The Batman arc was good. I feel like it could have been better, just because. Even if, let's say I accept his motivations, that hard turn, 3/4 of the way through, of, hey, we have the same mom name, like, hard 180.
Yeah.
He was ready to kill him.
Correct.
I'm just saying, I did not like that. I think that was not executed.
So, like, when a human being's looking
also,
for us,
hold on.
So when a human being is looking for a sign that he's either on the right or wrong path.
Out of curiosity, when did he ever say or suggest that he was looking for a sign?
Right, but Alfred was drilling it in his head continuously. Hey, you're going down the wrong path, and he didn't think so. And Alfred kept saying, hey, you're going down the dark path where there's no turnaround, and he kept going towards it. And then
they focused
on Martha continuously,
then he said the word. I'll give you that.
No,
that makes sense. The way you just explained it to me, that makes sense. Here's my only other question. He researched Superman. He knew Clark Kent was Superman, right? We agree on this.
That's the thing.
That look.
I mean, that's fine. That look, but it didn't seem like he did. Because if he did, why didn't he?
If he didn't know, I'll accept your explanation. I'll completely drop that point.
Right. Because I don't think he did.
I feel like he knew, and why the fuck wouldn't he have known her name before then?
That's why I'm telling you. I don't think he knew. I don't think he knew that it was.
But okay. Let's say we presume that he didn't know it was Clark Kent, which I think is questionable.
I mean, never once did he say it's Clark Kent.
Right. So if you didn't know it was Clark Kent, cool. I accept the Martha plot point. The Superman story as shown in theaters was a little weak. I think the thing that most people had problems with the Lois Lane arc was the only thing, like, on human level that made sense in the entire thing.
I mean,
because we needed proof to put Lex away. Because
everything else was other.
Everything else was just like. Like, you have the word of an alien who is not in question currently.
Yeah. And even then, everything is, as they say,
circumstantial.
Circumstantial. Yeah. And I was there, but it activated on its own. Like, who's to say otherwise? Really, listen, we're going back to reviewing.
The point is, the movie was good. It was not, you know, this
it wasn't bad.
Terrible movie.
It wasn't awful. Mm-mm. It wasn't, like, when you say bad and awful, to me, I'm thinking, like I said, we have a level. Fantastic Four is bad. Blood Rain is god-awful. So when you say either one of those words, that's what I'm thinking. Bad acting, bad script, bad editing, bad directing. When you're at those levels, and then I look at Batman v Superman, visuals were good. Acting was great. Visuals were great. Acting was great. Plot, I guess some people would argue that not so great, but still good.
Yeah, not like a shit plot.
Yeah,
not like I'm real mad at you.
Right. You say all that, like when you take all that into consideration, it can't be a bad movie. Now, you might have not had the experience that you were expecting, but you need to move past that and actually acknowledge the movie for what it has. Like I told you, I watched Luke Cage. I watched it within a day, and I said, it's good, right? Why is it good? Because everything's great, but what I was expecting out of Luke Cage and what I watched made that notch from great to good, mm-hmm. right? But I didn't say it was bad. I didn't say it was awful.
Right.
I said it was good because everything in there is great. The acting is great. The way that they want to tell that story is great.
Greatest joke in that entire series. I mean, I'm only on episode 10. I'm not right. done. But I'm going to say this is probably the greatest joke in the entire series. It was so, like, they force-fed that joke, but it still was freaking hilarious. Where Diamondback says something, and the guy looks at him, what you talking about, Willis?
Yeah, I was joking.
Could you write that in? Like, how would you, with a good conscience, write that in?
Doesn't matter.
But, like, still funny.
It doesn't matter. But as I said, you know, I didn't say it was bad, right? Because we have our level. We know what bad and awful is. So I feel like that a lot of these people that are writing, you know, critics or even that are making videos in their way of reviewing film or, you know, anything else, you have to realize what you're saying. To say something is bad, you have to have multiple reasons why it's bad. Oh, the acting was bad. The visuals were bad. Mm-hmm. The plot was bad. Then, okay, yeah, it's a bad movie. But none of that is true. You might argue that the plot isn't good for Batman v Superman, but that's one thing out of multiple things that make a movie. And so in that sense, it can't be bad. It might not be great or to your expectations, but it's still a good movie at the minimum. At the minimum, it's a good movie. So when you say something is god-awful, same goes for Dracula. If visuals were great, mm-hmm. acting was really good, I would almost say it was great. The plot, you know, some people would argue wanting to see Dracula as a good guy. Sure. Cool, whatever. I don't mind a different take on a story, especially if you're going to expand a universe. Mm-hmm. They have to look more as good guys, right?
Yeah, it's the same thing that happened in Suicide Squad. Suicide Squad, like you said, you wanted them to be hardcore bad guys that literally had a gun pointed to their head and said, do it because I'll blow your head off.
Exactly.
That's exactly the situation they were in. It's just that they painted them more like regular people and regular humans.
Yeah.
Like
there was potential of them being good.
Deadshot was like a relatable figure to me. Right. Like, he just wanted to be with his daughter.
Yeah.
Like, man, like, I feel that. I get that. Right. You know, like, I didn't have a dad in my life, which is like a really personal thing to
say.
Right. But, like, I didn't have a dad in my life, so, like, I feel, like, for that daughter, like, he wants to be with his daughter. Cool, I get it. That's cool.
Right.
And, like, the whole, like, friendship thing that...
Harley, a lot of people didn't care.
Really didn't like that whole Harley thing. You know, just... the characterization in that movie wasn't the greatest because they were force-feeding you this, like, well, there's, like, a light inside them.
Yeah.
Like, I get it. They're, you know, it's not... Like, that's not a great way to approach this. I think people would have accepted them being bad guys with a gun to their head.
I agree, because here's the way you got to look at it. So some people would argue that for Dracula and the monsters that are coming up. But here's the difference, right? Dracula and the guys that are coming up are the main characters. Where in this universe, in Suicide Squad, they're not. The main characters are Superman, Batman, Wonder Woman, Flash. They just live in that world. This happened to be a story about them being forced to do something that's mm-hmm. completely opposite of what they do.
That's a movie where I can argue.
But here's,
you had a lot of things that were wrong with that movie, but again, most of it was from a storytelling perspective.
Exactly.
I didn't hate the acting. I think the acting was good.
I mean, I think the
plot was super obvious. Like, it's, fucking obvious.
No, the plot definitely wasn't anything amazing, but it wasn't bad.
And see, it was also the same plot device. I feel like everyone's addressed this, but I feel like it needs to keep being brought up. Maybe it'll reach Hollywood. Maybe stop fucking doing swirly, like, energy things in the middle of the city. Like, everyone does that. I was thinking during that movie, I was like, was Ghostbusters happening on the other side of town? And then, like, Turtles on the other side of town? Like, it's all, like, it's the same exact thing.
You know, we reviewed the movie, and once again, I wasn't happy with the Joker. I wasn't happy with the whole them trying to make him feel more human because of what I wanted.
More human, like, loving?
Yeah, then the whole bonding scene. It's funny, though, but the guy who
created him was, like, he was like in tears. Yeah. He loved it.
Yeah, no,
and I'm like, that's not even the dude.
No, I know, right?
Well, the guy who created him on who created Harley.
Yeah, no, I got you. And so to me, even though there was aspects that I wasn't happy with, I didn't say it was a bad movie. Right. It was still entertaining. It was still
good. Super entertaining.
Yeah, so like I can't, just because it wasn't what I wanted 100%, doesn't mean I'm going to say, oh, well, you know, all the acting sucked. Nope, that's not true. Will Smith did a great job, as always. I always forget how to say her name.
Margot Robbie?
Thank you, because I say it weird and stuff like that. She did an excellent Harley Quinn. You take Harley Quinn from the animated series. You
could not have cast a better.
No, you couldn't. Good on her. I hope she continues this role for a very long time, because she nailed it. I wasn't happy with the Joker. I know Jared Leto really wanted to play a sadistic Joker, and he was a little upset or not happy that
he said there was a whole
there
bit,
was a yeah
there was a whole he's, bit he says, regarding yeah. that whole like collection of stuff
yeah
where he's like in the middle of that half circle
yeah.
He said there was a whole bit about that they
cut. He said there's a lot of scenes that they removed that he did, but I guess they didn't want it to make it feel too much about them.
And that's fine.
And that makes sense to me.
I think it was the perfect amount of Joker. Yeah. It wasn't a Joker movie. I think the next movie, which is supposed to be Harley and Joker, go nuts.
Yeah,
go nuts. Do whatever you want.
I just hope...
feel like they're going to try to make them be good guys.
Yeah, I know, right? But that's the thing. You know, even though we recognize problems with a movie, we still don't say it's god-awful or bad. It has to truly miss all the marks that make a movie for us to say that. So that's why I just do not understand how people say it's awful or bad or, you know, needs to take the taste out of the mouth. Like, that none of those make sense if the criteria of what makes a movie good is still all there. Just because your experience wasn't happy with it doesn't mean that it was a bad movie. I think that's where me and you review movies differently than from a lot of different people.
Yeah.
A lot of people ignore what makes a movie good, and they just like focus on the negative that they had problem with it, and then that's awful automatically or bad.
I think we've become such a critical society because your opinion is heard and reacted to so instantly.
Yeah.
If you tweet about something, people are going to say, oh, absolutely. Yeah, yes, no, whatever. Your opinion is reacted to so quickly, people don't take the time to like think
absorb
about
it.
You know, like yes, did we review Fantastic Four right after we saw the movie? Yes. But I feel like that was a movie that deserved a first
carnal reaction. But here's the thing. Me and you also, like, when I watch movies, I'm dissecting the movie as I'm watching it. Mm-hmm. So I'm thinking to myself, is the acting good? It was okay at best in that. Was the script writing good? As in, like, what's going to happen in each scene, what the lines are? That was horrific. Oh, what if we say no? Say yes.
And here's the thing. I don't mind that line if executed better.
Right.
Like if you had like Ben Grimm lean in and say, put his hand down and
bend the table and
say yes. That's more of an effect. Like some punk kid sitting across from you, say yes.
Oh, Johnny Storm, the thrill lover that he is afraid of heights. What? That does. Oh, she's from Kosovo, but no accent and nothing further explained. Like these are the things.
I'm saying if they do a second movie, I expect like a 10-minute sequence to explain all of that.
And
like why was Johnny Storm afraid of heights? Right. What about her from Kosovo? Like,
and the fact details. That the full fight. So you have Dr. Doom, right?
Also, Reed Richards is a bitch.
Right, Reed Richards is a bitch. And you have Dr. Doom that apparently can kill you by looking at you. But he gets ended in 3 minutes of total action in the movie with a punch.
Punching.
These are the things. Script bad. Acting okay. Visuals, I mean, there were decent ones.
I think the best part
was the thing.
I think the thing was fantastic.
And too bad they removed all the action that they showed in the trailer.
that was all on screens. I was so mad about that.
So, like, when you take everything into consideration, I think then you should be able to properly form an opinion. To criticize something just because you had a terrible experience with it, or not even terrible, but you didn't like one thing and that's what ruined it, or it wasn't what you were expecting. Like, as I said, I wasn't expecting Luke Cage to be what it was, but I still acknowledge that it's a good show. I just don't think it's great due to what I wanted. I didn't say it was bad or it was awful, because that would be stupid of me, because I can still acknowledge that things are done great or even excellent. Mm-hmm. Everybody acting in there, on par. I mean, I could not criticize anybody for their acting in that show. I really couldn't. I thought everybody nailed it left and right. I think the writing of that show, once again, excellent. The storytelling of that show, for what that story was, excellent. The only problem is, it brings it down from great to an excellent movie, which is right there with each other, to good for me, just because I wanted something a little different. But people take that right away, right? They're like, oh, well, it wasn't what I wanted. Mm-hmm. It's awful. It's god-awful. That doesn't even make sense. You can't, like, how do you say that?
Well, I think that's why I had such a, like, and it happens to everyone. It happened to me with Man of Steel. I was expecting...
Of course, yeah.
I was expecting a completely different look. Yeah. I was expecting a completely different feel of that movie.
But after you finally discussed it a few times...
The only moment, genuinely, where it was like a carnal instant reaction was that final moment. Where he's standing there, he's about to kill them. He's holding him, like trying to hold his eyes away from that family. And the whole time, I'm thinking, what is the Superman way out of this?
Right.
Because to me, Superman is this beacon that cannot do wrong. Yeah. He will find a way to stop this dude peacefully.
Absolutely.
And he snaps his neck, and I was like,
yeah, me too.
And instantly, I knew that you had to do that.
You had no other choice.
You had to
do
that.
You just became Superman. And you don't have the Phantom Zone, how do you stop Zod?
There was no other way around that, and I thought it was a brilliant way to do that. Again, looking back on it, I feel like the things that I had a problem with, once I analyzed it, once we talked about it made more sense to me once I thought it out. The movie itself is good. My only having had several problems with that movie, after thinking about it for several years now.
Yeah, now your only biggest problem is the tone. You just wanted it to be
just
lighter.
Just remove that blue filter. Right. Just remove that dark blue filter off everything. Somebody did it. I'm gonna link down below for that.
Yeah.
It's beautiful.
Yeah, you like it when...
It's
when
so they, bright. It's
because they just color corrected it to be a brighter
movie.
Yeah,
that's all they did. Yeah. They changed a single thing. And it was literally night and day.
Yeah.
And that's why one of those things where... In Batman v Superman, the trailers looked like it was going to be brighter.
Yeah, it did.
It wasn't
there was a few moments in the beginning. It did look like almost like when he's in that car driving, like everything does look brighter for a bit. But then it just goes back into being a dark. Which, here's the thing, at the current moment, nothing. I get the darker filter. One, mm-hmm. it provides that kind of mysterious look to the and gives it a nicer. I mean, not necessarily nicer in the sense that people want a brighter look, but it does give it a more of a nicer cinematic look to mm-hmm. it, right? And I mean, so I get his thinking on why to do it, but it's still, for me, I'm looking at the situations and stuff like that, there's nothing bright and gloomy of any of these situations, right? Superman just got done trying to save the world that doesn't even know who he is, right? Now... Some people love him, and some people are trying to figure out if he's truly there for them or if he's a threat. So now he's got to try to figure out do I continue helping them and let them judge me like they are? Or, do I not help and step away from them? Right. Or do I help and not care what they have to say, right? Do I be that person? Do I be above them, right? So, there's such a big dilemma. None of that is... bright and happy, even when he's talking to Lois and stuff like that.
The only most of it happened.
I do hope that Ben, since he is directing Batman, I hope he stays away from the filter.
I think Batman, most of Batman is going to take place during
the nighttime. Well, it's going to be during the nighttime anyways,
so
but
have
I
those
just...
dark shots.
Right,
and I feel when they had the dark shots, when they had...
The filter was gone.
The filter was gone.
Yeah.
But it was clear as day, no cloud in sight.
Right.
That shot where he came down in front of the Capitol building or
whatever. Yeah.
There was not a cloud in that sky, but it just looked hazy. And I was like, man, the suit they'd filtered the suit down.
I could have sworn it was cloudy. Mm-mm.
I don't recall. I don't believe, but like, not like to the level of like where it would affect the
sure,
because the color of his suit in those scenes specifically looked muted.
Right.
Like even like it looked duller than other scenes.
And I think the other reason for the duller, the muted suit is because they're trying to play into the less cheesiness of it. Right. They figure the brighter the suit,
But it's like it's not even. I understand that.
Right.
Well, that's why they made the suit a darker color and all right. that. The red's darker, the yellow's darker, everything's darker. And I understand that. My only problem with that is that when you go from scene to scene, and in one scene, which is daylight,
right.
it's a darker suit than it is in the nighttime shot.
Sure.
That's when I have a problem.
No, I got you.
But I mean, again, these are all like nitpicky little things, and
but that's doesn't my make only a, beef but with that doesn't make a movie bad
exactly.
or awful.
Like, Man of Steel was an outstanding movie.
Yeah, like acting wise, it was phenomenal.
My own, like I said, my only beef that I've got left with that movie is that tone, and like
yeah.
otherwise, I think visually, I think
and everything else makes sense. I mean, once you diagnose it, once you dissect it, everything makes sense. Like everybody's like, oh, but this is not the Super movie. No. If you watch interviews...
No, the Superman movie that the people who say that wanted
yeah.
came out. Everyone hated it. It sucked.
Yeah, it did suck. It was awesome.
Superman Returns.
Yeah, it was... Let me rephrase that. It was a good movie. It was not a good superhero movie.
It was
not a good Superman superhero movie.
Here's the thing. I think it was less exciting than Steel. Did you ever see Steel?
I did see Steel. Was Shaq?
Steel's in fun movie.
It is a fun
it's
movie.
Bad.
It is
like,
bad.
It's bad. It like, is Shaq bad. Is not a good actor.
No, he's not a good actor.
But it's a fun movie.
But it is a fun movie.
And it's like, in comparison, like, so you have Steel, which is like, low budget.
Right.
Like, not, the effects were like 90s effects.
Let me put it this way. I was more interested, after watching that, and now knowing about Superman Lives, I really... I'm more interested to see what would have happened with that than having
Superman. Returned. I think Superman Lives would have been a better movie than Superman Returns.
Even though it had some crazy ideas.
Yeah. Even with the giant spider.
Even with the giant spider. But
I'm sorry, the Thanagarian snare beast.
Yeah, that's right. But yeah, so I really hope that, you know, I really want you guys to reply to us, right? What is your... I'm hoping that we maybe have now shown people how not to jump to like instant that was a bad movie. Like, calm down.
Also,
like you can't just say it was a bad movie because you didn't get what you were expecting. That's why me and him always go with the least minimum possible. Like, we know what we want, but we still, with our expectations, we go as minimal as possible.
Mm-hmm.
So we expect the movie to be decent. Not awful, not bad, just decent. And if it meets those expectations and then some, we are happy, right?
Absolutely.
So it's you can't go in and be like, I know exactly how this movie should be. Well, then you should maybe become a director. Go make a movie, because if you know how it's supposed to be.
That's the thing, a lot of people, and going back to like, you know, what people say are bad movies, people hated X3.
Yeah.
I think... it was as good a story as you could tell based on the stuff they already done.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
I think Brett Ratner did great stuff. I think Brett Ratner...
I mean, like, visually it wasn't bad. Visually it was just as good as all the other ones.
I think Storm was done in the best possible way you could have done. I think Storm was characterized better in 3 than she had been in the first 2 movies.
That's fact. I'll argue that with anybody. That is a fact.
Every single thing... I mean, I think you saw stuff out of Xavier, like, out of all the characters, you saw stuff that... even wouldn't even be touched in the comics for a few years. You know, the stuff about it, like Xavier's kind of sneakiness and
yeah.
like, oh, I'm gonna, he's like that smile, right?
When
he disincorporates that smile, I was like, that son of a bitch is up to something.
The only problem I had mainly with that movie was the fact that like Jean or Phoenix ended up killing like a lot of people, right? And even though you can play that off and bring them back, because I mean, it's a comic book movie and they've been coming back multiple times. There's, you know, it's not like you couldn't have brought them back, but that was like my really biggest problem. I didn't like the acting, nobody did any less of an acting job than in the previous movie. So,
if anything,
acting was
if
good,
anything,
if
people
not
did
great.
A better job.
Yeah, exactly. Visuals, just as good as the other ones, can't complain there. So, what's the problem? Oh, the one part that I had a problem with? I can't say that's a bad movie. Because if everything else hits the marks, I can't say that's a bad movie.
I think the biggest thing was that people were expecting, like, people didn't want a watered-down Phoenix story.
Oh, sure. I mean, they wanted more.
You can't do the cosmic Phoenix story.
I mean, they might be now. Maybe now? We'll see, yeah.
But still, they've already laid the groundwork that they're not going to.
I mean, that's true. I mean, it's already still within her, so.
It's within her. I mean, and I actually was watching some stuff and reading up on Phoenix. I actually just read the Inferno storyline, so there's a lot to that. There's,
sure.
It is connected to her even before.
I see.
So they could still do cosmic, you know, space stuff, you know, Shi'ar and all that stuff.
Right, right.
And that's fine. But, like, that doesn't make it better. It just makes it different.
Different, yeah.
Like,
it just makes it what you were expecting, right? And it's like, that's the difference, right? Just because it's what you were expecting, you wanted the space story, then you like it, right? But the minute it's not something you were expecting, but doesn't mean it was bad, just wasn't what you were expecting, mm-hmm. All right away it's awful. I'll never understand that.
I think that's the main reason people say stuff like that, is you end up wanting something out of a movie. And I think there's an article that I shared on Facebook some time ago that was talking about, like, watch, like, take art in as it's made.
Actually, you know, I just thought about a movie that we watched this year? I think it was this year.
Mm-hmm.
Once again, we talked about this, right? Because people were like, oh, it wasn't as good. It was Star Wars. Was it this year or was it end of last year?
It was last year. It was Christmas.
You know, Star Wars had a bad rep. They were like, oh, I was just taking stuff from the old ones. But here's the thing. Acting from all these characters, or I'm sorry, from all these actors was better than the old ones.
It was all good.
You know why that's a fact? Because the art of acting has gotten better since then. Yeah. So it's a fact that it's better.
Nobody
did bad. Are you kidding me? Riley did an amazing job. So did, I forgot the gentleman's name, the British fellow, her other, like, he was playing against her the most of the time, that picked up the saber at the end, that we thought he might have been. Finn's the pilot. Isn't Finn the pilot?
No.
So it was Finn. But what's his name?
De Boyega.
Okay. He did a great job. She did a great job. Everybody did a great... The only... I will say this.
Adam Driver
was awesome. No. You didn't like him?
I didn't like... I don't necessarily know that it was his performance, but the way they made that character, he was such a little whiny.
Oh, yeah, I mean, yeah, you didn't like that aspect.
He was a child.
No, to me, the only person that didn't do... Yeah, you don't like Kylo, right? The only person that I think was, like, you could tell that she didn't act for quite some time. Princess...
Leia.
Leia.
I mean, like, Carrie Fisher has not been in acting for a long time, yeah, but at the same time, like, she wasn't a key character.
She wasn't a key character, but you could tell her scenes, like, you could tell that Harrison Ford's acting versus her acting in the same scene.
He wasn't acting. Harrison Ford is not acting. Harrison Ford is just Harrison Ford.
I mean, that's true.
At this point, Harrison Ford just is all the characters he's been, so he doesn't even need to do anything. He's just that guy.
But still, I mean, the difference between what I saw from him on screen and her on screen, like, that was, like, the only thing. But, like, visually was better. Graphics in general have gotten better since the old ones. Period. You can't argue that fact. That's a fact. So, to put those two things against it right there, okay, so you're complaining that the story was similar. Well, last time somebody tried a different type of story, which was the creator of Star Wars.
It wasn't even that.
Everybody hated it.
The entire universe of Star Wars is very cyclical.
Yeah.
Like, the original trilogy, second movie, someone lost an arm.
Yeah.
Prequel trilogy, second movie, someone lost an arm. Guess what's going to happen in the next one, kids?
Someone's going to lose an arm,
and it's probably going to be
And Rey. We've already decided. The story is always going to be around one family.
Yeah.
It's never going to change.
I don't care what my wife says. She's not a fucking Kenobi. She's a Skywalker.
No, she's a Skywalker for sure. But, like, that's the thing. Like, once again, going back to, like, people are like, nostalgia. That's what I wanted to go for. People are so tied into nostalgia that they're like, no, this is the best Star Wars movie, end of story. Yes, if you saw it at that time and it was something you grew up with and something you just cannot release from your brain as the best movie ever, then absolutely, you're going to say that for the rest of your life, but you're not taking into consideration anything else that makes a movie. That's the problem. Like, I easily can say certain movies are great movies and probably one of my favorites due to all the things that make a movie.
Yeah.
So that's, I think, I hope that we've shown some people how to now, from now on, look at movies. I'm hoping some, I'm obviously not all, but I'm hoping
if
some.
If anyone listens to this, and maybe has an ear of the Collider
crew. Yeah, get the Collider crew to talk to us, because I'd love to have a conversation with them. Because
I've met Schnapp. Schnapp is cool people. I had nothing against these people.
Oh, yeah, you did, yeah.
I got nothing against these people, man, but I would love to have that conversation. I would love to have a conversation with Schnapp about Amazing Spider-Man 2, because his opinions on Amazing Spider-Man 2 and his actual statements about what he wants from a Spider-Man movie widely differ.
Oh my God, it's insane. It's insane. But yeah, so if you guys have, if you know how to, you know, get a hold of Collider for us, we'd love to have that conversation with him.
And if anyone from Collider's watching, we'd love to have that conversation.
We'd love to have that conversation. But let's talk about, since we now have drilled how we look at movies and shows, let's talk about Luke Cage. You're up to episode 10. There's 3 more episodes left for you. I think it's 13 total. Mm-hmm. I finished it. I did it within almost a day. I did like 2-3 episodes. And like I said, I think it's a good show. I think it's, honestly, if I was to be honest, it is a great show considering what is in that show. To me, I wanted more from Luke Cage. I wanted more from that character. I wanted, he is a invincible, strong man. He shouldn't be scared of somebody that beat him up in prison. He shouldn't be scared of somebody, or he should wanna, I get him not wanting to help people because he's second guessing, right?
He wasn't afraid of him because he beat him up in prison.
He was.
That's not why he was afraid of him.
No, originally he was. He was definitely, like, there was some fear there because
it wasn't fear. I think it all stemmed to him not wanting to go back to prison.
I mean, maybe that's possible. That's cool. I mean, that's fine.
He didn't know, like,
yeah, no, that's fine.
What that guy's situation was.
But to me, it's. I wanted more from a guy that is. So, here's the conversation me and you had. I said it's a good movie, but I hope to God that good show. But I hope to God Defenders doesn't have as much spent on talking and stuff like that. I want more action. These are superheroes with great talent. Like, here's the thing. To me, period, Daredevil is the best show so far out of these three. Why? Because they incorporate talking and the amount of action equally.
There's a lot more action, but here's the thing. I think the main difference, and I think each show has its strengths, and each show has a very, very clear vision of what they want.
I mean, that's true.
Daredevil, the way they characterize Matt is that he is dead set to have this vendetta, this vigilante approach to justice. Because
he needs to save the city.
It's very much like, I'm going to do this regardless.
Yeah.
It destroys, like, his relationships and everything.
Nothing's going to stop me.
And, like, it's done excellently. In the entirety of Jessica Jones, she wanted nothing to do with that life. And the only reason she kind of, like, owned up to it was that, like, if I don't do this, no one's going to.
Right.
That's kind of like how we ended up with the ending we did.
Yep.
In this, it's about a man who is a righteous man. He was a police officer.
Yep.
He was wrongly convicted.
Yep.
And he was given this gift that he didn't want.
True.
And it came after the most vicious beating he's ever received.
I mean, that's true.
So he's in this position where, like, this is a curse to him.
Right.
You know, he was expecting to die.
Yeah.
And right now, you know, I'm on episode 10 where he talks about, nine and 10, he was talking about how his idea of the counselor, I forget her name, it's funny because I was watching a couple hours ago, but the counselor from the prison, the idea of her is what drove him, is what kept him sane. And now that he's, like, now that that's been ruined for him, that's been destroyed for him, you know, he doesn't know what to do.
Yeah.
You know, the guy from the beginning, Pop, he basically, like, not coerced him, but he, like, taught him that he should do something with this.
Yeah.
And, you know, he called him Power Man, and, you know, he kept that. He kept that, because he mentioned it later on.
Yep.
And it was just one of those things, like, he's building up his personality to be a hero.
Okay.
I love the little drops of Heroes for Hire. Absolutely.
I mean, there's quite a few drops for Heroes of Hire.
I ain't no hero, pay me.
I do like also the little throwback to the old suit from the comics when he escaped amazing. The prison. That was
you look like a damn fool.
Yeah. So you know, like I said, I'm not saying it's a bad show. I can't say that because that would be a lie. But I wanted more from a guy that has super strength and involvement.
I understand, and here's what I think. I think the way the story was done, I think it was done to be, like, the longest movie ever.
I mean, you're right.
The way it builds, it has a couple up and down beats. It never, like, no episode resolves anything.
Yeah.
You know, even where we got rid of, you know, one person from the beginning. I don't want to give away too much. You get rid of one person from the beginning, a bigger issue comes up. So right. It's like, it's written the way, for me, a good book is written.
Right.
You know, one of my favorite books that I've ever read is, like, everyone makes fun of the guy, but it's James Patterson, First to Die. And the last, like, five chapters, mm-hmm. it's like, the whole, like, last third of the book, you're like, I know who the guy is.
Right.
And then it's like, boom, crushes that theory. Then you're like, all right, well, then it's this other person. Crushes that. And it's just like every chapter, it keeps changing. And you're just like, what is going on?
Right.
You know, so there's never a final ending until they want it. So that's kind of what I'm thinking here is going to happen here. You know, we've had these, like, ending beats, right? You've had the one guy dead.
Sure.
The one, you know, then the one cop
right.
was resolved. And then you have all these, like, little dead stops, but they also create bigger issues.
Yeah.
And different issues. And now, you know, they're talking about the guns being given to the cops.
Yeah.
And now I'm just like, well, that's an even bigger issue
right.
at that point. So I think they incorporated it really well. I think they wrote it extremely well. I think they brought in the real life, like, social injustice stuff expertly. I don't think you could have done it better. I think they didn't, like, flood it. They didn't throw it in your face. It wasn't, like, Black Lives Matter in your face.
Right.
It was a lot of little things. And they showed multiple different opinions.
Yeah.
In the one speech, like, towards the beginning of one of the first few episodes, somebody was like, if black lives are going to matter, we need to take pride in our communities or whatever. And I was like, well, I'm like, that's, you know, that's not the popular opinion.
Right.
But that's one opinion. And then they showed another opinion. And they showed, like, kind of all the varying opinions. There was the one cop in this episode was like, he's like, I'm from the South Bronx. He's like, I'm 20 years on the job. I'm not some fool. That's some young fool who's afraid of blacks and Latinos. Yeah. I know what's going on. You know, it's just this old grizzled cop. Yeah. But he's like, I'm not one of these idiots.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I know what the hell's going on.
Yeah.
And I'm like, we're seeing kind of everything. We're seeing the cop's point of view. Yeah. We're seeing everything. And I'm like, I think it's great
that they framed
this whole, like, social situation that's really, really tense in our real world.
I agree.
In this show that's just
That's why I said I can't say it's a bad show, because everything's done excellently.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, everything. The storytelling, the little bits of real life in there with, like you said, it's just kind of like telling a movie but in a longer fashion. You know, it really is a great telling of a story, but like I said, the only reason it's not great for me, which, I mean, I can say that it is a great show for what it is, but for me, ultimately, it's good just because it's the little bit that I'm missing of what I wanted from the actual character, Luke Cage. But, I mean,
I think you're going to get it in Defenders,
though. I think it's all going to build
very well.
Well, I mean, you'll see.
I think they're going to also incorporate Punisher into Defenders. They are shooting Punisher.
Right.
I don't know if they're shooting the Punisher, like the show. I think they are shooting. But somebody was talking about that the director of Punisher was on the
Although Shield I hope set. They, I hope
that he was on the Shield set.
Well, here's
the,
well,
I
let's,
would
let's,
love a crossover.
Let's, well, first of all, let's talk about a few things. One, for Punisher, we definitely shouldn't get a
origin.
We got an origin. We got a little bit of an origin, but we don't need an origin.
We don't need an origin, no, absolutely.
We do not need an origin. We know his family got killed.
Even with Luke, like, we got the origin, I think, really well. They didn't make it about that.
No, they definitely didn't. He was like, here's how I became Luke Cage, and here's how I got my power. Like, it wasn't just a full-on thing. So
yeah, it wasn't, and it wasn't, like, it wasn't about that. It was, granted, though, it was kind of like a flashback episode.
Right.
But they did it in such a way that it was like, I think for me, it revealed more about who he is and why things are happening the way they are, more than like how he got his powers
Absolutely.
To me, it was more about his characterization. And I thought, Reva? Yeah, Reva. Like him talking to Reva and all that stuff, like that to me, like filled in more of those gaps, like story gaps, versus like how he got his powers.
Oh, no, no, I agree. I agree. I think. Once you see the end of episode 13, the last episode, I think we're definitely gonna get. I'm hoping I'm right. I obviously can't say.
I know Danny's in it.
Oh no, Danny actually never shows up.
Oh, they said that he was in the last episode.
I didn't see him. unless I missed it, I'll have to rewatch to see. But
I didn't see him. I mean, maybe it was just rumor, but I was under the impression that he was in the last episode.
I mean, there was a rumor going around that he was supposed to be in the show, but I never saw him.
Here's the thing: I would like, because they even talked about you know, when the one chick made a speech and she was talking about like, oh, the woman, like the super strong woman who like cracked a guy's neck in the harbor, and I was like, oh, like they're making like conscious references.
Although I will say this, the fact that I keep forgetting her name, but the medical chick, like, she was really in this series. Yeah, Claire was in here way more than she was.
I also like that they developed her in this, because it was like, you know, what are you gonna do? Right. Oh, I think I want to, like, I helped these people who are helping other people. Yeah. I think I want to help those people, which then brings her to be the night nurse, which is what they call her in the comics. I think that would be amazing.
That'd be great.
If she created some sort of, like,
I think they are. I mean,
traveling van or something.
It definitely looks like they're going that route. I am excited for Iron Fist.
I think that'll be a heavy action show.
But I hope it is.
Because it's all about martial arts.
I get it, you got to develop a story, but if you've done it with Daredevil really well, there's no reason why not to be able to do it well with Iron Fist.
Here's the thing. From what I understand, the show focuses on him returning to New York.
Right.
To me, that means he's already got his powers.
Right.
We'll get a flashback.
The little trailer we saw, he punches a wall, so...
Right. Did they have energy on his hand, on his fist?
They didn't show that part. They just showed the wall blow up.
Ah. I'm expecting that we'll have a flashback to Kunlun, which is fine. I would prefer a flashback.
I think the little bit that we're going to see about his parents dying in the airplane crash is going to be flashbacks. I don't think that's going to be full-out like episodes, which I'm perfectly fine with that.
I think Cage is going to be in it.
I hope so.
I would love for them to start like Heroes for Hire as an agency at the end.
Oh, that'd be great.
The Misty Knight got shot in the arm.
Right.
Claire's like, you're lucky she didn't lose the arm. I'm like, she's going to lose the arm. Yeah. And then she gets a Stark Tech arm.
maybe.
Well, she's supposed to get a Stark Tech arm.
Oh, we'll see.
Oh, yeah, maybe she didn't lose it here, but I'm saying. Anyway. She brought that up, and I was like, Misty was part of Heroes for Hire. I'm like, this is gonna happen. Misty Knight is outstanding on the show. Misty Knight is outstanding. Her whole like Wolverine thing that she does, where she like looks at pictures, like he does the smell thing.
Yeah.
She looks at pictures, and it's like, what happened? I think
I think that's dope as hell. I don't
remember if that's an actual like ability of hers.
Right.
Also, I kind of want them to not put her further in the show. I want them to do her and Colleen Wing. I want them to do the spin-off show because they're called Daughters of the Dragon.
Colleen Wing.
Colleen Wing's another character. She's a martial arts character. She's a here's a sword.
Oh, okay. So I haven't seen her yet.
No. I don't think she's been on the show. On any of the shows, but yeah, it's kind
of.
I was also thinking it's like a duo thing.
Jessica Jones' friend too, though.
Oh, Hellcat.
Yeah. Not necessarily her own show, but I mean, at least incorporate her well in, like, another Jessica Jones series.
Yeah.
Like,
I want her to get a costume.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, she already knows martial arts. We've seen that.
I mean, that's kind of the whole thing. She was always, and they played it really well. Patsy Walker in, like, the 60s or the, like, 60s or 70s was a, like, a fashion book.
Right.
It was, this was back in the day when you couldn't do names like Hellcat.
Right.
Because you couldn't say things like hell, you couldn't say, like,
right.
crime on the cover, so, like, a lot of books got canceled, and they made a lot of books for, like, little girls.
Sure.
And she was a model, and it was, right. like, oh, her, like, being a model and hijinks.
Right.
And then, like, when those books died out, for whatever reason, I don't remember, I read the Marvel Chronicle, but I don't remember what the actual reason was, they took that character and turned her into Hellcat. And it was, like, when they debuted Hellcat, they were like, oh, it's Patsy Walker. And it's, like, no one really understands why it happened,
sure.
but it happened.
Right.
And so the fact that they've got her being like a public figure, she's a news, sure. you know, news person, and then she turns around and she's going to be this badass, and I'm like, that's cool.
Yeah.
Because you kind of play into that. Like, you weren't expecting it. You know, she was just like, oh, she was somebody who was stalked, and she had the, you know, the high security you put in, and then when that episode happened, and they, like, she opens that door, and she's got that training thing,
yeah.
I was like, damn.
Yeah, no, I'm like,
she's going to be mean.
I agree. So, yeah, but I mean, overall, like I said, I just want it a little bit different from Luke Cage, but otherwise, it truly is a great show. I mean, I can't. The only reason I say it's good instead of great is because of my little thing that I wanted from it, but it is, like, I can easily say it is a great show. It's just, for me, it's more good than great because of what I wanted, but. Yeah. And that's, once again, going back to what we were talking about, that's like you gotta step back
take
and be like,
into account.
Exactly, like, you gotta step back and be like, listen, everything was done excellently, but just because it wasn't exactly what I wanted doesn't mean it was a bad or an awful show. So
since I'm looking in that way, I think I've got it on the shelf there. I want to bring up one last movie, sure. for this. Green Lantern is almost universally despised by the nerd community.
Yeah.
And if you look at it as a Hal Jordan Green Lantern movie, it's not good.
Right.
It's not good.
Right. If you look at it as a Hal Jordan.
Here's the thing. If they had just called him Kyle Rayner and made him an artist instead of a test pilot, because that really had no bearing on the whole show.
Although, in the New 52, that is what more Hal Jordan is like.
He's more... Well, he's still not that joking.
Not that. Right, not that.
Hal Jordan never was and has never been portrayed, sure. as far as I'm aware, as a guy who would leave the skank from last night at his crib.
Yeah, no, I got you.
Like,
no,
to bounce
I
and go...
No, I got you.
You just... That, to me, like, that scene, like, as soon as it opened with that, I was like, bad taste in my mouth.
No,
right away.
No, I agree.
And...
But here's the thing, but it's still not an awful movie.
It's not an awful movie. It has a terrible villain. It has the same problem,
I mean,
Rise of the Surfer did.
It
has a cloud.
It does. It's a cloud. It's...
But, like, other than that, I think it
had potential.
I mean,
Ryan Reynolds
potential.
Still does a great job. Everybody in there did great acting. Visually, I think it was... I know a lot of people hate the animated suit. But here's the thing. It makes sense to me. The suit is something that he creates, from what I understand. It is...
Yes. It makes sense that way, and I don't disagree with you. I think it just... Maybe the graphics weren't up to par, but
I think
feel like
here's the thing. I think the suit graphics are up to par. I think it's the mask. The mask always looked off for me. And when I looked at his face and he had the mask on, it always looked like...
Didn't make sense to me, because you could have just put a green mask on
him. I know.
And then
I know. That's what I'm saying.
And,
like,
yeah.
It always looked off.
It was just like,
I
feel like the actual cinematography was good. I feel
absolutely.
The acting was decent.
I mean, when they were in space on the, like, Lantern
I think
world.
Everything on O was beautiful.
Oh, it was great.
I think everything there was done well. I think the problem was that they tried
Sinestro
to make this like
perfect.
An Earth-centric story with, like, this whole
right.
Oa thing.
Yeah.
And I would have rather seen him get his stuff.
Yeah.
And then go fight and...
But once
maybe
again...
Maybe not fight Sinestro right off the bat.
Not right off the bat.
I think Sinestro was excellent in that movie.
Oh my god, yeah.
Great actor for that, too.
Oh, perfect, yeah.
But I would have wanted to see something more spacebound. I think that's the biggest thing people have a fear of making with these cosmic
characters.
They take these cosmic characters
evidence.
And they put them on Earth.
My favorite comic book movie, Guardians of the Galaxy.
Mm-hmm.
barely on Earth. The only time it's on Earth is the beginning when they show him.
It's barely on Earth, but they do put them on planets.
They do put them on planets, which I understand. I mean, you have to go to different planets to get, you know, information, to get the object that you're looking for, all that. But it's different, and it's not just Earth. It's alien stuff. Mm-hmm. Like, the one thing they go on is a giant robot head. I mean, like...
It's not a robot head.
I mean, whatever. It's
the head of, it's the head of a whatever. It's the head of a celestial.
Whatever. It's the giant head of a celestial. Whatever. But
they seeded the planet with life. It's okay.
It's okay. but that's like a perfect example that you should not be afraid to take a movie to space because you're worried that it might not connect with people, because that movie made so much money and almost nobody knew about the Guardians.
That's what I'm saying. I think that was one of those things where, like, that Deadpool, although Deadpool was making more of a comeback in the comics, but it still, I think, wasn't as big.
Right.
Nowhere near as big as, like, X-Men or Avengers or whatever.
No.
I think that and Suicide Squad was another, I think, big risk. Huge risk for DC.
Yeah.
I think they put some real good names behind it.
Oh, absolutely.
And they brought, I think Suicide Squad, right off the bat, I think their trailers were okay. I don't think their trailers were great. I think Suicide Squad
made money off
of name brand.
Oh, absolutely. And
I
thought,
I genuinely wasn't expecting it to.
And I think the other... I think the other thing that was really selling the movie was Joker and Harley.
Mm-hmm.
I think even though Will Smith was in there, Joker and Harley.
Yeah. That's true. People know Joker and Harley. I think that's the other reason a lot of people were mad about Joker and were mad about there not being enough Joker. Because they knew Joker and Harley. They went to see Joker and Harley.
That's true. Even though it was a Suicide Squad, and I know why they eliminated a lot of the scenes for Joker, because it would have then felt like Joker and Harley and not Suicide Squad. But no, you're absolutely right. That is another perfect example of people going too far and saying what's horrible, and instead of, okay, it wasn't exactly what you wanted, but it wasn't truly that bad.
The villain was bad. The Joker. The graphics weren't that great in certain areas.
In some
stuff it was fine. Yeah. In other things it just wasn't good.
Right.
And then the characterization of Hal Jordan specifically. I think otherwise everything else is great.
I think everybody did a great job acting.
Even the one little one-off shot of Amanda Waller, which is, by the way, why we're not going to have that have anything to do with the current DCEU.
No, it's not.
Because Amanda Waller is a completely different person.
And plus, we're not going to see Ryan Reynolds come back or anything like that. And we spoke about this. Since this is a tangents thing that we do.
Yeah, speaking of Green Lantern.
Right. Speaking of Green Lantern, we believe it should be Jon Stewart. Go with Jon Stewart, eliminate, mention Hal Jordan for like a scene or two and be done with it. And just stick with Jon Stewart. I don't see why this would be difficult.
It's not difficult.
It doesn't need to be Hal Jordan.
It makes great sense.
And here's the thing. With
the Justice League being new, Jon Stewart on the show, in the comics, Jon Stewart is the military trainer of the Justice League. He is a military man, like a career military man.
Absolutely.
So like him, you know, proving himself to be a hero or something, and then like Ganthet shows up and he's like, listen, some shit's about to go down.
Right.
We need you to like hold down the fort here. You know, usually, you know, we pick someone to watch the whole sector. We've got a guy doing that already, you know, from Earth.
Yeah.
But something's happening here. You know, he doesn't even know you're getting
exactly.
You know, just kind of like Ganthet, like doing his Ganthet thing. Like Ganthet in the comics over the years was shown to be kind of sneaky, kind of a little underhanded, kind of like, I would do to just get shit done.
Right.
Not necessarily like what I'm supposed to do.
Right.
So, like, I feel like Ganthet would be the one to show up and be like, listen, here's a ring, handle your business, I gotta go.
But, I mean, the other thing to me is, like, if they ever wanted to go, because Hal Jordan becomes evil at some point.
Yeah.
So, like, if they ever even wanted to do that story, it's not like they couldn't. Like I said, if you keep just mentioning him in pre-Granola, and then let's say you cast the actor to act him, and then you show him in a scene or two where he is a good guy, he's taking care of certain things in sectors, you just show him real quick, and then at some point, like, Jon Stewart gets a message, something's going on, or, you know, not even just Jon Stewart, but let's say the Justice League gets a message, something's going on, hey, something's happening with Hell, whatever, and, like, you can play that off anyway. You don't need to have
Hell. The only drawback to that without a Hal Jordan movie is that it wouldn't be as big of a deal.
Sure. But I mean, but that's what I'm saying. But if you,
history of Hal Jordan being
no, absolutely. But here's the thing: I don't think you need a movie for Hal Jordan to incorporate him in the story.
Just like live, like, make the myth.
Yeah, exactly. Right? Make the myth. The like, myth here's of the Hal thing. Jordan. Hey, huge fight with the Justice League. Hal Jordan shows up to help out, right? He's there.
Just shows up, like exactly. Just stomps down, yeah. like
a group of villains, or yeah, somebody, whatever. Yeah.
Somebody huge.
Yeah.
He just shows up, knocks it out.
Yeah.
You're like, no worries. I was actually just kind of visiting.
Exactly.
Saw this happening. I'm going to go.
Exactly. Like, you bounces. Can always throw him in, and it would be perfectly normal, because who's to say that a guy that literally goes across universe to save planets couldn't do that? Mm-hmm. Like, you can't even argue against it. So if you just keep incorporating here and there, you could easily still go that route if you really wanted to go to that story, right? If you needed another big bad or something
build,
like that.
If you build the myth of Hal Jordan, yeah, that'd be cool.
Absolutely.
But again, you know, that requires long-term planning. And I think now that Geoff Johns is in charge,
yeah.
I think now that they have their own fight, yep. Geoff Johns weaves a good story. Geoff yep. Johns wrote Green Lantern Rebirth.
And here's the thing.
Wrote a lot of really
here's
good
the
stuff.
Thing. As much as people didn't like Batman v Superman or had their problems with it, maybe not necessarily not like, but had their problems with it, let's be serious. We saw that trailer for Justice League. That is all we needed.
I don't need to see another
I don't need to another see scene, another one.
Picture.
I am ready.
I don't see anything else.
I am good ready. To go. Like you said, when Bruce Wayne says, I hear you talk to fish. Dude, that alone is such a dick Bruce Wayne thing to do. But
he's up there, Arthur Curry. Awesome. I hear you talk to fish. You son of a bitch.
And I love the part with Flash. Like, he's like, oh, you're fat. He's like, I feel like that's...
A bit of an understatement.
An understatement. He's like, I'm building a team. Yes.
Done.
Just like that. I love it. There's
gonna he was be, like...
But here's great. The thing, and that makes sense, right? Barry Allen... Okay, Barry Allen necessarily isn't a comical guy. I always confuse Barry Allen with
Wally.
And Wally.
But here's the thing. I think they could portray him this way in so much as he's a CSI guy, right?
Yeah.
He's a crime scene investigator. He's Dexter.
Yeah.
Like, without the murderous streak.
Right, exactly.
Like, he's a guy who lives in a lab.
Like,
he doesn't have friends.
I'm perfectly fine if you want to make him a little more comical. I think
how he copes with literally
exactly.
Pouring over murder scenes
exactly.
and blood spatter
yeah.
and all this, like, it's how he deals.
Exactly.
I'm
like,
I know
we were just talking about how people had a problem with Hal Jordan being comical, but here's the thing,
well,
him being comical is fine. Him leaving a girl he just banged in his house, I think that's the big difference.
Right, it's different.
Right? Him being
it's
funny
not quite
is
as that.
Fine. Him leaving a random woman that he just had sex
it wasn't, with. It wasn't just the comedy. It was the characterization.
Of
the
course.
Things he did, the way he
yeah,
talked
yeah.
to people. It just wasn't perfect. And then there was that whole thing where, again, you know,
tangents right.
But going back to that, there's a whole thing where he, like, weeped. He was like, I don't think
yeah,
I can do
yeah.
it. And I'm like,
that's not Hal Jordan.
That's not
but,
anybody from DC Universe. DC is, like, gods.
But, yeah, as we were saying...
But, like, I think they could do that, make him funny, because there's scenes, there's moments. Like, that Grounded series, the Superman Grounded,
mm-hmm.
there's a moment where he talks about it. He's like, how do you, I think it was from that one. Anyway, he's like, how do you see the world? He's like, it's just a big blur, right? Because, like, I'm going so fast,
yeah.
right? And he goes, and, like, later on in the story, Flash shows up again. He's like, you're cool, right? He's like, well, you know, I'm just trying to, like, find my way. He's trying to reconnect with America. And he's like, you know, I was just joking when I said it was a big blur, right? He's like, I see everything. Like, I see everything, but I'm able to do that
right.
you know, in Flash. And he's like, I've beaten you. He's like, I've beaten you every time we've raced before. I think it was during the story.
Right.
And he looks at him, he's like, those were for charity, Clark. I was like, that's awesome.
But that's the thing. Like, I think making somebody funny is not a huge change in characteristic.
And
to
it's not
where,
even
like
he's like a...
But regardless, I'm super excited. I was worried for the actor that was portraying Barry Allen, but now once I saw him in the trailer, I was like, I'm done. I'm sold. Like, I'm ready for this movie. I don't need to see another trailer. As much as here's the thing. I'm the person that loves to see as much as possible because it just keeps giving me more so I can feed that want to see the movie, right? But at the same time, I agree with you. I think this is all I need. Don't show me anything else. Just keep playing this.
To close this out, the the thing, I came to a decision with this with the Civil War trailer.
Yeah.
I'm not going to, like, once I'm sold,
right,
not watching any new trailers, any new TV. He's like, this, like, my whole, like, obsession with watching everything I could find started with the first Transformers movie.
Yeah.
It was like I found pictures and I found little set
shots. Oh, yeah. That's I was doing it like that.
Engrossed. Because I feel like that really, like, started this big movie train. So, like, that, after that, it was like when Iron Man pictures came out, you saw this, that, and the other thing. And it just, like, every time.
And then
time,
you had the Man of Steel where they were talking about it's being shot in Illinois. They're showing the house
exactly,
and all that.
Exactly. So it was like everything, like, I kept wanting to see more and more and more.
Yeah.
And then I ended up watching the Civil War trailer in the second one,
and there was just so much,
and it was like the Spider-Man entrance, and I was like, not necessary.
Right.
Not necessary. You could have shown the thing where he fought, like, because they did, like, a week later,
yeah,
the thing where he was fighting Winter Soldier. He's like, you got a metal arm, that's awesome.
Right.
That itself could have been in the trailer.
Right.
But that, like, as soon as they dead stopped the trailer, and I was like, there's still like 10 seconds left, I was like, Spider-Man reveal.
Yeah.
And it was like, underoos, and I was like, son of a bitch, because I knew that was, so that was the entrance spot, like, it was, I knew that was the moment,
right,
and wasn't, like, I knew it was gonna take down the impact of that scene.
I will say
the same thing with Wonder Woman, although I think that scene was still great, I still reacted very cool, I still had,
I mean, I still got goosebumps. I really got goosebumps the minute they played the music and she dropped in. I legit got goosebumps.
I really liked that entrance, so I was really, really excited to see her. But at the same time, like, as soon as they panned,
I love her song.
As soon as they panned, I knew what was happening.
Yeah.
And I was like, damn it, like, I wish I didn't.
Right.
Just the entrance. Show the fighting. Show anything else.
I agree. No,
that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. Once you tell me, you know, let's say this person's going to be in the movie.
Yeah.
I see the costume. Cool.
Yeah, I just want to see, like, don't show me where they're arriving. Don't show me where they're going to, like, where you're going to introduce them. That's giving away too much of the movie.
I'll be honest.
Don't get me wrong. Like I said, I'm one of those people that wants to see a lot, but you don't need to necessarily. Here's the thing. For me, none of these entrances ruin it because I know that they're going to be there. So as I'm watching the movie, I'm like, and here's the moment. Like, even if I didn't know that was the moment, I most likely can call it because of the way I'm watching the movie. But it's not necessary. It does ruin the
give it a
the
little
surprise.
Bit.
Yeah, you know, give it a little ruins bit. The not even necessarily a surprise because you know the character's supposed to be. But that initial, like, hit, like when Wonder Woman came in and saved Batman, like, even though I still got goosebumps because it's me and
it
I just
if
love,
you didn't
I
know that that's when it was going to happen. Right. I think if you didn't know that that's exactly when it was going to happen, I think it would have been a much, much bigger hit, and I think they could have had a way better scene.
But I will say this to finish it off. This is, and you can go through any movie you want. This is the first time that one trailer has sold me.
Can I say that I'm sold on a movie right now that doesn't have a trailer? That has only had a total of, as far as I'm aware, 7 posters.
What movie?
8. Power Rangers.
Oh, I agree.
Not even.
Yeah, no, you're
because
absolutely
it's
right.
Power Rangers. Like, I'm a huge Power Ranger.
I mean, we grew up with them. We grew up with the original Power Rangers.
The little stuff they've shown.
Yeah.
The way they reveal it.
Listen,
like,
I like
the Zords.
I like the Zords. I like the suits, and I like Rita.
Did you see the sword? That was the period on that side.
I did not see the sword.
They showed the sword, the Red Ranger sword.
Yeah, I know.
And I'm looking at it, and I was like, that looks dope. I'm done.
Awesome.
I don't even want to see the rest of the weapons.
I think this is going to be a fun movie. I don't know if it's going to be amazing. I don't even know if the acting is going to be great.
They're all new kids.
But here's the thing.
I think it's going to be fun.
I think if anything, it's going to be fun. Mm-hmm. And I think visually, it's going to be great.
Yeah.
Are we going to end it there?
I think we'll end it there. Appreciate you guys for watching or listening if you are on the podcast.
Yep.
Make sure you check out youtube.com/T3G Tech. Make sure if you are watching this to check out soundcloud.com/T3G Media.
T3G something?
Media? Just look for #tangents
or,
on SoundCloud.
Or it's in the description
also
below of
there.
The video. Also as well, make sure to check our social medias, which are all linked in the description below.
Yep.
Make sure to like the video if you did enjoy it and you were able to stay this long through it. And also as well, make sure to subscribe because we do more than just this stuff. We do vlogs, tech, gaming, TV, and movie reviews.
We're almost, I've got 20...
What don't we do?
23 days left. I think we're... This is like, whoever stays to the end of this...
Right.
...gets to know this.
Right.
Here's my plan. I'm going to share this with the viewers. My plan is to get to 150 vlogs.
Right.
And then start the new channel.
Okay.
Kicker with that. It's going to happen. The last few vlogs are going to happen at the same time as me starting another channel. Because I think I'm going to do NaNoWriMo as the first 30-day challenge for the vlogs. Mostly. I think keeping myself but I'll only do a weekly update.
Right.
So I have, it's 50,000 words in the month of November.
Right.
It's like 12,000 words a day-ish, I think. No, that doesn't make sense. 12,000 words, like, a week.
Right.
Yeah, that makes more sense.
Sure.
So if I can get 12,000 words a week, and I, you know, that I'll do that video.
Uh-huh.
That's the challenge. So it's going to be a weekly thing for that, but anyway.
Once again, thank you for watching and listening. I'm Haris.
Dalibor.
And you'll see us in the next one, or hear us.
Yeah.
We won't see you or hear you.
Later. One day.
One day.
Different technology.
Yeah. Later.